here. My talk is about the benefits of combining post-mining with Lean Six Sigma. And when we first started, like 3 years ago, within our organization, with experimenting with post-mining, one of our biggest challenges was to combining this two methodologies and to set or to build up a detailed business case at the beginning of your change process, of your project. So, at Volker West Telecom, we design, we build, and we maintain the telecom networks that our society needs to stay connected to each other. You can think of your internet connection at home, or your television signal, or your mobile phone, or your phone, the right signal for your phone if you go to a festival. At Volker West Telecom, we got 1,600 employees. We got 4 operating companies, and we've got 3 portfolio companies that are operating in software development, IoT, and radar systems. My name is Robin Schouten, and I work at Volker West Telecom as a consultant. What I'm going to do with this presentation, I give you some insights in my project, so my change project, and I picked some tools from the different phases. And but because I have not enough time so to give you all the tools, so I picked some tools and I pull you to the high level change of the project. So at the beginning of your process, it's very important to define your customer needs. And within Lean Six Sigma, you do that with your CTQ. That is your critical quality trees. And what you want to do is you want to define your voice of the customer. And so for example, you have your process X, and then you take your operational definition and your goal, and then you want to define all your customer needs. So that is in the Lean Six Sigma is that a voice of the customer. And in our particular case, we had to deliver our design within 41 working days with the right amount of quality. So if you have defined the voice of the customer, the next step to set your boundaries in your project, so the beginning of your project, you want to divide your operational definition into your drivers. So in this particular case, we had 2 drivers. The first one on the left side is the timely delivery. So that is most of all known as our throughput time. And our second driver was the quality for our product. So if you have your drivers, then the next step is to define your KPI and your KPI score. So in this case, for the timely delivery, we had our upper specification limit, so the 41 working days, your throughput time, your KPI. And we defined for the lower specification limit, we defined 0 working days. And we defined it at 0 working days because in this particular case, we had no external influences from third parties that can really impact the beginning of your process. So this is very important because if you have third parties that can influence the beginning of your process, then you want to adjust the KPI score to like 10 or 20 working days. but it's different between the process you're working on. Our goal with our quality driver, it was to get all the required information, and information must be correct. So we had the 95% inside the norm with a 5% outside the norm. And our score here was a measure with the first time yield. But we had no extra data structured to take a deep dive into the quality. So we take here for the measurement, for the score, for the KPI, we take here the first time yield. But if you have more data, like defects per unit, then you can deep dive more into this driver. But in our particular case, we have only the first time yield. So we take the norm of the 95%. And I want to give you some insights further into the quality driver to set up a detailed business case for your project. So what is first time yield? So first time yields is it's like in post mining names, it is your rework percentage. So it's the similarity here, that is exactly the same, but within Lean Six Sigma you also have scrap. So maybe the most time within post mining you are in an office environment, but if you are in an office environment, then you mostly have no scrap. So first time yield. So you have your input in your process. So you push your items into your process activity, and the next step or the next steps within your process. If you have your project done, then you have your inspection step. And if that, if you have the right amount of quality, then you have your items out. So if not, then you have your scrap or your rework loop into your process. And that's most likely your quality issue. And within Lean Six Sigma, you have a couple of options to calculate this. If you are lucky, you have your Power BI dashboard. But if you have not, then you need to calculate this within Excel, or you need to calculate this manually. And it is, if you want to calculate this manually, then it's a very time-consuming a part of your defining for your first-time yield. But on the other hand, if I take a look at post-mining, then I can import my transition log, and I already see directly what my first time yield is. So I picked the 100% minus the 16.1, and I see I have the same percentage of the first time yield that you can see on step 4 of the process on the left side. So dit is the conclusion is it's the same conclusion, but the post mining way here in this particular part of the project is much faster. So if I take the first time yield and I want to calculate this within my business case, and I do this at the beginning of my project, then I pick my first time yield per activity, and I calculate that, so I multiply that with the price of my rework item. So my rework item, I calculate with your hourly rate, multiply with your post time, and you multiply those two parts, and then you have your calculation on your yearly basis. So that is hard benefits of only one process activity. So you do that for every process activity, and you add some other hard benefits into your project. and then you combine them all, and then you have your expectation of your detailed calculation for your process. If you have that number, then it's very important to reduce the number to till like 50 to 80%. Because you don't want to create a high expectation with your customer. Because if you don't achieve your goal, then you have a disappointed customer, and then most likely your whole project have no support in your organization. So that is very important. And if I have my business case ready, and you have a goal from your process owner, then you can start beginning with analyzing your process. So within Lean Six Sigma, I first ask myself the question, do we have a value stream mapping? In this particular case, I talk about the value stream mapping in current state. So you ask yourself the question, do I have the value stream mapping? If not, then I need to plan some brown paper sessions or meetings to get to the value stream mapping. So I need really to set up the process in the current state. And that's very, in Lean Six Sigma, this step is very consuming, time consuming, because it takes like maybe 1 month before you have your value stream mapping on point. If I go to post mining, then I've got my event log. Now I validate my event log. I import it to Disco, and I filter some things, so my spaghetti to my lasagna, and then I got my whole process, and that's directly my value stream mapping on a particular height of my process. For the next tools, and it's the analyze phase, I want to go to the first driver, so that's my timely delivery. And if you have your value stream mapping ready, then you can do the analysis within your process. So in the Lean Six Sigma project, I want to dive deeper, also with post mining. But if I look at the Lean Six Sigma project, then it's very hard to see where the bottleneck is, so the place into your process. So I want to combine here, in my analyze phase, I want to combine post-mining, and I want to combine Lean Six Sigma into my analyze phase. So I want to interact to those two methodologies, because first of all, I take my bottleneck analyze within post-mining with the total time, if you can see on the left. And you can see very fast, you can see your bottlenecks into your process. So, this particular map, I export, I think, the beginning of your process. So, before my business case, I export this map, because I really want to set my target, so aiming on a particular bottleneck. So, for example, bottleneck one. And I want to set up, build my business case around this one bottleneck, so I can have my support within the organization. If I start my analyze phase, I pick the same map, so the same post map, but then I want to dive a little bit deeper into the analyze. And what I do is I pick my statistic tools from Lean Six Sigma, so it can be a box plot, it can be a correlation, histograms, interval plots, and I'm looking for different factors within your process. So the differences in your process factors. If I have some differences, So, for example, here I've got three regions, and you have here some differences in, between those regions. And if I have one, then I do a hypothesis, and if it's significant, then I go further into your analyzer. So then I pick post mining and I do some analyzes with the particular differences. And I do that back and forward the whole time. So if my hypothesis is like my p-value is below 0.05, then I go further into my deep dive. If I have my deep dive, on the right side you can see, you cannot read it, I think, but I have the inside norm of my KPI. This, so that is the design that delivered in between the 41 working days. And I got my outliers. So every project that is outside my norm. And there, if you pick post mining, that you then you can also see your place that you have your bottleneck within the deep dive. And that's very important because if I have only Lean Six Sigma, then you have very flat data, so it's all statistical graphics. And within post mining, you have a clear picture of where the bottlenecks happen. So you can switch back to your statistical software and you do your statistical tools again, your statistical analysis, and then you can go to deep dive in those three blue squares. If you have found your root cause there, eventually, you can do your hypothesis again. And if that is significant, then you have eventually your root cause. And then you can pick your current state process. In this particular case, in this process, we had like the intake of your process, so that's the gray step. But I want to dive a little bit deeper in the midsection of this process, because our first step here was to create a low level design, and if we there's a completely detailed design. And if it is done, then then it goes to the next step, so the field check of the customer. And there we go into the field. So employee from our organization go into the field to the customer and look how the design match with the environment within the customer. If that's done, then we have our quality check, and our biggest question here was to our biggest how do you call it? Our biggest challenge here was our quality issue here. So the project came from the field check of the customer. The next step was the quality check, and you can see you have some differences within your design and the field check of the customer, and then it goes back into the low-level design, and you need to start over again. So we had a very big issue here in the quality. If you have your current state process and you had your root cause, then you want to look with your team. You want to design your future state of the process. So what's my root cause and how I design my new process so I can reduce my root cause of the process, so my deviation. In this particular case, we add a high-level design. So that was a basic design of the network. And it was linked on the basic content for the field check of the customer. So if the basic design was done, then we do the field check of the customer. And the next step, the field check of the customer came back from the field. and the high-level design. And then we check if there are differences in our high-level design and our field check of the customer. And if it's not, then it goes further to your low-level design. So then you upgrade your basic design. And if not, then you change here in the middle step of your process, that change your basic design. So it can also be going to the next step. And the last step is the quality check. And if you have defined your future state of your process, then you want to test the future state of this process. So then you want to start the pilot study. And if you have your results from your pilot study, so here you can see on the left side the current state of the process in the box plot. And you can see that the performance is like between the 10 working days and like above 60 working days with the stars. And the median is on, just the modus of the graphic is on the 20 working days. And you can see the differences in the future state of the process. So you can see that is that we reduce the deviation, and that are like 100% is below the throughput time from 40 working days. If we look at the results from the coverage, case coverage, then I had in my pilot a 0.0%. So in my pilot study, I have a first time yield from 100%. So that was a very positive result. But if I take this results, yeah, it's very important to look at your results. In this case, you have a first time yield for 100%, but it's not. It's very important to know that you have always deviation. So if you want to calculate this for go no go moment for implement this particular process, you want always take your first time yield from the first sheet from 95%. So there you want to take the 5% off, and then you want to calculate your current state process, and you want to minus that with your future state process. And here is the same, so you got your forecast, so the numbers is based on the forecast for the upcoming year, and if you have your forecast from the calculation. And also here is the same for the expectation, for the support. You take the 50 to 80% reduce. So, and if you have a goal, you can implement your process. And if you eventually implement your process, then you have your control phase. And there you control your implementation for about a lead time of 1 year. So, what helped me about combining these methodologies? Both methods really complement each other, because if I look to Lean Six Sigma, I can really deep dive into the root cause. But the disadvantages from Lean Six Sigma, I can't see the place where the bottleneck happens. So I can target it within the place that I need to target it. If I combining process mining with Lean Six Sigma, I take the process mining to really look at the target of your bottleneck. So I can really aim into one place. And if I need to go to the statistical tools, then I use Lean Six Sigma to upgrade your analyzers. So Lean Six Sigma is a structured way, a pragmatic way to approach your change of your process. So that was very complement each other to a higher level. Also with process mining, I've got a clear picture of my process. So I've got within the organization and my team, I've got more recognition into my project. And I've got more interaction and therefore also more support to the whole process of the change. Disadvantages were the difference in the design of the databases. So what I mentioned earlier in the analyze phase, I go back and forward into the analyze phase, but if I do a back or a forward, then I have to go to change all of my database manually. So it takes a lot of time to change my databases for the back and forward and the deep dive for my analyzers. And that was my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Sorry?
Thank you very much for the presentation. We always encourage the speakers to show details. I really like the concrete way you showed, for example, the first-time yield calculation. I'm sure some of the also Lean Six Sigma people will recognize some of the things. And for those of you who want to read more, so we will distribute the public slides later, probably next week or so. So you can also look through some of the details again in more detail if you want. Please think, let me know if you have questions for Robin. I will start with the first question. In the beginning, you were already defining some targets, right? Like a high level, the 41 day was the upper limit that was allowed. And then you said zero working days is the lower limit because it's actually possible to do it on the same day. There's not like a minimum before.
Maybe it's not possible in 0 days, but we have no influence from third parties that can impact the beginning of your process. So we don't have to define the lower specification limit.
Yes.
So we have only upper specification limit.
Exactly. Okay, that's good. And so my question is, when you define these targets, mm-hmm. then it's a little bit of a chicken and an egg problem, right? Like you said, also in between somewhere, expectation management is also important. If you have a very high target that's very difficult to achieve, then that might be disappointing for people that they're not doing very well. So, but at the same time, you have to know how the performance is before you can set a realistic target. So how do you resolve this chicken and egg problem in practice?
It's very important to get your support within your organization. So you want to set your target not too high, but also not too low, so it depends on what your goal is, but it depends also on your own expectations. So,
yeah,
that's us.
Yes. Okay, who else has a question? Let's start with Sjoerd.
Yeah, thanks. In your presentation, you were referring to process mining and Lean Six Sigma as two methodologies, right, that seem to complement one another. My question is that, to what extent after this project, do you think that process mining cannot complement, but actually substitute different stages of Lean Six Sigma? Because reconciling the two in one project, from my point of view, requires additional competencies, right? You need to be able to work both ways. So I'm thinking, to what extent maybe process mining allows you to upgrade, you know, the Lean Sigma methodology, because, you know, like with the value stream mapping, you don't have to do it via workshops anymore, but you just chug in the data and, you know, it produces a chart that you can use for Lean Six Sigma purposes. So what's your view or experience on that? Now you've reflected on doing a project that includes both.
First of all, if you have post mining, you want to deep dive to analyze, there is a limited factor, then you can deep dive into your process. And at that point, you need to pick some statistical tools with other attribute data, so that you can see the differences within a particular part within your process. So, if you see those differences in your process factor, then it's also very important to see your percentage of your hypothesis. So, that is the very I think that is the most important part of the Nisi Sigma part into this to combining these two together. But I also use Lean Six Sigma in the structure of your DMAIC. So the DMAIC is the roadmap of Lean Six Sigma, and I really use this roadmap to I think that to not miss something within your project. So I want to define see every detail, and I want to define my project. I want to measure my whole process, and then I want to analyze, improve, and controlling my process. So that was the two most important things that I get from Lean Six Sigma.
Thanks.
It's a bit of a related question, but perhaps from a different angle. So it's clear that Six Sigma and process mining have a lot to do with each other. And Lean Six Sigma has been very successful, both in a commercial sense, but also in the sense of creating like a certain culture around it. But they also have adopted many other techniques. So for example, in your talk, you talk about box plots as if it's Six Sigma, but box plots existed 40 years before Lean Six Sigma came into existence, right? So, so my quick question is twofold. Let's say one question would be, why is there in the Lean Six Sigma community resistance towards adopting process mining? Because it's just like they adopted box plots, why don't they adopt process mining? Or the reverse is, how can we improve process mining tools, methodologies, to really, let's say, cover the whole thing, rather than just being the tool?
Yes, that's an interesting question. So, first of all, I think the obstruction with the Lean Six Sigma group is that Lean Six Sigma is very based on not if you are not in an office environment. So it's very to machines and like that.
But process mining is used by all car manufacturers in the world, right?
Sorry? So
process mining is also used by all car manufacturers, or I don't know. Like what I tried to say is process mining is also used in these environments.
Yes, but it's different. Process mining is one tool, so you can do a lot of analysis with process mining, but Lean Six Sigma is more likely than a toolkit. And you pick the tools that you need to do your analysis. So now I do it on the other hand, so I pick Lean Six Sigma and I put post mining into my toolkit, and I reduce the number of tools within Lean Six Sigma. But it's depending on your needs within your organization. So it's very different, because the one organization do Lean, the other do Six Sigma, the other Lean Six Sigma, the other Scrum. The other only post mining, but
it's a bit similar. Like in some companies, they have a process mining group, they have a BPM group and they have a Six Sigma group, which is, yes, of course absurd because they're all doing the,
yes, that's,
same
that's,
thing.
Yes, that's
right?
A little traditional way, yeah, but in the companies that stay ahead of the curve, you see that you're combining your IT organization with your RPA and your data science and your process, your operational excellence department. So,
okay.
I wanted to add to that. That's what we are seeing too. So initially there was a lot of reluctance from the Lean Six Sigma community, but over the past years that has changed. So they are much more open now to also adopting process mining, for example, to replace value stream mapping like you have shown. Okay, another question over there.
Okay, thank you. Robin.
Hi.
Hi.
About the whole Lean Six Sigma, there are a lot of communities in many companies. I worked on a project for ABN AMRO Bank, not a manufacturer, but also an administrative environment. And they also have Lean Six Sigma, green belts, black belts, everybody walking around like judo champions. So it just depends on what you encounter and embark on it with your process mining tool, I say, because I also hear this discussion that, of course, Lean Six Sigma is more, sounds like more like nicer suit, haute couture, than a t-shirt, right? So that's me also the difference in approach of what is the definition of a methodology. But that was not my question. My question is you mentioned something that triggered me. You got more recognition in your project, you told me.
More support.
More support, more interaction, and the other word you used was more recognition.
Yes.
I was triggered by recognition. How did it come about? What happened?
You can really visualize your process. So, if you go to the floor, so to the employees, and you take the picture of your process map, then they really can see what's going on in the real process. So it's not your ideal process, mm-hmm, but it's your fact-based process. Okay. And then if you look with your team within this process map, then you have very fast interaction,
okay, cool,
with your team. So then you have your recognition of the team. So they start asking questions about the process, and they directly come with solutions on,
okay,
the process.
Thanks. So that's not only Minitab you use anymore. Thank you, I rest my case.
Okay, we have a question here.
Yeah, my apologies for my double dots speak, but.
Yeah, we have a question from the online community. So Roel is mentioning that, of course, data and data preparation is a big part of doing a process mining analysis. And he is kind of hypothesizing that could it be that the data preparation itself could be a bottleneck for the Lean Six Sigma expert?
So I can't hear you because of your mask.
So is the data preparation itself, is that maybe one of the bottlenecks of the Lean Six Sigma expert using process mining?
The preparation of?
So the preparation of the data, could that be the bottleneck for the Lean Six Sigma expert to use process mining?
To set up your data within Lean Six Sigma is very time consuming, but it depends on your analysis. So it's very time consuming. But if you take the same data and you take it into your event log, and you can analyze everything, and you put some statistical tools into your process mining, then maybe you don't need the whole Lean Six Sigma toolbox.
Yeah, so are these event logs, are these type of data formats, are Lean Six Sigma experts used to using these formats for doing their statistical analysis, or is this a completely different type of format? So from your experiences, would you use event logs also for your statistical analysis?
Yeah.
Okay. So that should not be an issue then.
So it should not be?
So the getting the data in the event log format with the case ID, the timestamp, and the activity is already kind of familiar for a Lean Six Sigma expert. So that's something that's being thought as part of the green belt or black belt.
Your training. Event log?
Yeah.
Oh, no, it's not the same. So,
okay.
So if you go to a Lean Six Sigma expert and you go with the event log, yeah, they can look at the data and they know the definition of the data, but it's you have differences in the structure of your database. So in Lean Six Sigma you have your on your project, so per project you have one line, and in the event log you have multiple lines about the project. So the back and forth in the event log between the event log and the database with Minitab or statistical software is that if you put the data from your statistical software database into your event log, then you have a lot of the same data, a lot of the same of attribute data. So that's the differences. And in the database from Lean Six Sigma, there you have one line with one cell that's filled up. So.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Any more questions for Robin? No? So then let's thank Robin once more. Thanks so much.
Thank you.